Hi. My name is George. This is my Twitter handle and GitHub handle and everything handle. The slides for this talk are available there on GitHub. There's also a Russian version, but currently we still have people who speak English and are interested in Tabula Open Valor. So I'm going to try to open the I'm also one of the people who had to like switch places because I cannot do dates good. I booked my return flight for tomorrow for some reason because some valid dates. And you probably expected this person, but that's that one. Yeah, so life changes people. Just a second, and then I'll load my notes because I don't really remember what I was about to say. All right, there we go. So I work for this company, SoundCloud. I live in Berlin. SoundCloud is one of the leading streaming platforms for music, podcasts, sounds of sneezing hedgehogs, and you know, all kinds of things. We have this wide variety of people, like this ACDC and Led Zeppelin, high tier content from the major music labels, and then also like underground music, like this Ukrainian artist, and then type light band thing. Some podcasts, Haskell podcast, and thank you for hosting their content. It's quite a good podcast. Listen to it, it's very nice. Please do use us. We're fun. We have around 12 hours of content uploaded by creators every minute, and we get like around 35,000 listening years every month. And we have around 125 million tracks on the platform. So to compare to like, for example, Spotify has like 30 million. And we have all content that they have since 2 weeks ago. We've signed Sony, and before that we signed Universal and Warner. So that's also there. We're aiming at being like the biggest sound platform ever. We're in a quite unique position with regards to that because we're like open. People can just like come to our platform and upload their music, either like garage band or some like in-house music producer, creator, DJ, whatever. They don't need to be signed by a label. And if they upload stuff like AC/DC or Led Zeppelin or Britney Spears, the system will figure it out and they will get some kind of punishment for that. And some will be taken down, of course. We have about 5 petabytes of files of like stuff, and then to compare to Spotify, they have around 1 petabyte. And we have, and our team is like 10 times smaller, for like 300 people. Maybe 200 in Berlin. So yeah, trying to compete there. That's what I was actually talking about. Okay. Things from daily works, you know, like war stories, like maintenance of a server was postponed by some rappers sending songs to each other, you know, like with stuff. A lot of people think that we are a Ruby shop or a Go shop or whatever else shop that you could have read on our blog. If we're anything shop, I would kind of say that we're a Scala shop, but so we have a zoo of technologies, right? Like, for historical reasons, we have Ruby. We started out as a Ruby monolith in 2008. The code base, the monolith which we started like getting rid of it in around maybe 2011. The first project that we The first project that we first part of the sort of the system that we of the system that we got rid of was in-app messaging. We basically took it out, re-implemented it for some reason in Scala. I think that was the first Scala project ever in the SoundCloud. It was rewritten 3 times. I personally rewrote it twice. It went well, and we kind of decided to go that way because the whole, like, for obvious reason, the whole monolith was just like not scaling in both like programmatic way and in like human way, like 50 people trying to contribute to the same big thing over and over, and like deploy was taking it still takes like 40 minutes of the thing that's left from the monolith. Before my time in SoundCloud, I heard that there were like 3 people who could deploy Mothership, and like if someone goes on vacation, we don't deploy Mothership because we don't deploy Mothership without those people around. They just, you know, for good luck and stuff. Like the whole thing was at some point we decided after extracting the messages from the platform, the project was we called Tongo. We decided that it's a success. We should do more of that. We extracted like creator stats, so like analytics for creators, where when your sound was played, liked, reposted, whatever, commented on. We extracted feeds, like pretty much everything critical to us. We tried to extract from the mothership. We didn't have any guidelines on which languages to use for that, so Scala was one of the first. Before 2012, we had like, I think I went through the history of like our GitHub repository, and it's like at least 50 languages for some weird things like I haven't heard before. So that was fun. At some point, we decided to finally converge on JVM. So nowadays, it's mostly Scala. We have some Clojure. We have some JRuby for historical reasons, because we have a lot of very, very, very good Ruby developers, like ridiculously good Ruby developers. They managed to scale this mothership up until 2012 and like make it work for tens of millions of people. I don't know how they did it. It's just like some weird voodoo shit. So the reason I personally believe that the reason we ended up with mostly using Scala for, so like as far as I've seen in the last maybe year or year and a half, every new service that needs to be like spawned gets spawned in Scala. Even though we're like historically a Ruby company and most people feel more comfortable with Ruby, they still use Scala because we have this framework on top of Finagle. We're using Twitter Stack, by the way. We're using Twitter Stack because we have the same investors, so we have like very tight bonds with them, and they went through this like microservice refactoring a year ago before we kind of had to. And so we figured like, well, I mean, it worked for them, so kind of worked for us, I guess. And so we have this like library on top of their Finagle web RPC framework service builder thing, which basically it adds all the bells and whistles that we use in our infrastructure. So you can like create a Finagle based web service in like 3 lines of code, and you get for free like monitoring. We're using Prometheus, which is our internal tool for monitoring. Well, it's actually like nowadays it's more or less external. We've open sourced it, and a lot of companies are using it. It sends like errors to Airbrake. It would like log the deployments into the Slack channel and all that. So like all of the bells and whistles you get for free, and you just like don't write anything. I personally think that was the reason why Scala was so popular. So yeah. But, TLC. What is TLC? TLC is a short name for type level compiler. The name has been actually endorsed by Daniel Spivak. I think he came up with the name, and so he's really proud of that name. And so he's really pushing towards using that name. There is this blog post that's called Type Level Scholar in the Future of Scholar Ecosystem. So basically, the reason. So anyway, we all love Scholar here, right? We're all here because we enjoy writing Scala, or we are being pulled by the Stockholm syndrome for some reason, sometimes. Everyone has their own reasons for that, and there's this guy Travis Brown wrote a blog post about why he likes Scala. It says the name of the blog post is "Roll Your Own Scala." I did not think about highlighting the URL here. If you open the GitHub repo, there's you can click that. In that blog post, he is basically trying to work around partial type application, all the known weird stuff about Scala, partial type, things that people don't really like, partial type applications and how they're types, and there's this bug with its S5.2.7.12. He's trying to work around that a little bit, and he's working around broken, what he perceives as broken things in language with other broken things in language, and as a result he gets something quite nice looking. So that's his reasoning for liking Scala, and at the end he says, basically, to recap, we've taken a few basic but still pretty broken Scala language features, singleton types, refinement types, type projections, and the implicit resolution system, and we've very painfully built a language for ourselves that at least kind of looks like supports partial type parameter application, parameter unification, and multiple implicit parameter sections. And then at the end he says that, I think that's pretty neat, but I can also understand why almost everyone else would find it horrifying. So the point that he's trying to make is that this kind of interaction of sort of broken things which are there for historical reasons or have been there for just accidentally, things like type lambdas. No one actually created type lambdas, they just were the language appeared to be able to express those things, and so that was just there broke by luck. And he's basically making a point that these things, they don't really make people come to Scala, but they make people stay with Scala. TLC. What are we trying to do with forking a Scala? Why and how, and aren't we trying to break the community into type level Scala, and then light band Scala, and then there's also this Lara Scala and other Scala, Doty, not really Scala. all these Scalas. Why are we producing them? What's the reason? So I personally like to think about TLC as Scala for people who are kind of nostalgic about pre-2.10 things. So if you've used Scala before, I personally, the first version of Scala I used was 2.7, and I think when I started, 2.8 was released, and so we were our team was migrating to 2.8, and then a few years later, 2.9, that was very painful, but still very rewarding because a lot of new changes and almost complete rewrite of collections libraries or new parallel collections and all that. So that was like, from on the one hand side, it was very painful. On the other hand side, it was like very rewarding. And you know, for people who are who miss those feelings, we basically forked Scala. We added some of the features that we first of all could, because we're not compiler developers. We like all have full-time jobs, which are not developing compilers. On the second hand, we like wanted these features in the language, and LivePen was not really happy about the entire implementations. We were just anxious to like try them out in the wild. If they're gonna work, if we're gonna be using them, they're gonna be like just worth it. And the whole idea is that the fork is kind of beneficial for both type level and LivePens in the sense that we get to battle test the ideas that we always wanted to battle test, and they get some assurance that we're gonna, if we're gonna send a pull request with a new thing, that thing has been already used in production. There are people who understand how it works. There are some, we like understand the corner cases and all that. And another thing is that we really want to be backwards compatible with LivePen Scala, in the sense that all the features that are like different behavior from the LivePen Scala, we want to put them behind the flag. So if you use TLC without the flags, it should behave the same as Scala C, so exactly the same way. So this is how you can already use it. Apparently, SBT is awesome, and starting from version 0.13.6, they allow using Scala organization. 0.13.6 was like what, a year ago, and I have no idea how they learned about the fact that there might be different Scala organizations, but they actually implemented support for that. There is a published 2.11.7 version. There's also a published 2.11.8 snapshot and 2.11.9 snapshot. I published 2.11.9 snapshot yesterday in the evening, but be careful, I haven't really tested it. There's a pull request to the TOC GitHub, but so anyway, what are some features that we added on top of Scala? So some of the features are we added first class syntactic support for type lambdas. We added another annotation, implicit ambiguous. It's actually coming to Scala 2.12, and this number 4673 is the pull request in the TypeSafe Scala repository. We added one of the implementation of support for singleton types, the thing that Dmitry was talking about, which is also known as 20-string. A thing that we call irrefutable generator patterns, and we added some stuff to the parser to make it, you know, just nice. So type lambdas. How many of you know what type lambdas is? Okay, so a lot of people actually. Okay, so type lambda, you need a type lambda when you want to partially apply a thing with like several type parameters. So here I'm defining this. Has anyone been downstairs to the monads functors thing talk? Okay. Do people just know what a functor is in general? So functor is a thing with a map. And some laws, but like we're not going to talk about it. But it's like a map which conforms to some signature. That's all we need to know. So this is where, this is how we define the functor. There's some map from the functor that takes an f of a and the function from a to b and returns an f of b, and it behaves like you would expect the map to behave. And so you would, you probably can imagine how you would define an instance for a functor of like a list. You would just use like list of map, or an option was option dot map, and you don't need to do anything on the like to satisfy the compiler with regards to types. You probably imagine how you would define a functor for an either. You would do like if the thing that you want to map is on the left, you would do like left dot left map, or if you do the thing for dot left dot map, and if the thing is on the right, you would do dot right dot map. But then if you just write that in the definition of the instance, that would like the compiler would say like there's like too many holes in that type and like don't really understand what's going on. So this is where type lambdas come. You try to satisfy the compiler telling which hole you need built. Here you say like on the left please. So this is a type lambda. And then this is what the same thing would look like with our type lambdas. So basically it kinda looks like a type function, right? Like from some y to either something on the left y, right? Some more examples. These are all valid type lambdas. So things that you can put in type. This is a quote from a very notorious person in the Scala community. His name is Paul. He's famous for a lot of things. I think the biggest Twitter storm was when he like quit TypeSave because reasons. And one of the he has a lot of very very great quotes, like seriously very great quotes. And one of those is on one of the tickets over there, he said, "Type lambdas are cool and all, but not a single line of the compiler was ever written with them in mind." Well, now there's a few lines to support that in type level Scala. Next, implicit ambiguous. Who has ever seen a thing where you're like, okay, who has ever seen a thing where you're like, I want this function to like work on stuff, but I don't want it to like return a unit because I don't want people to like print to it or something like that. So like I want the function to like work on units, like work on whatever string, work on anything, but if I pass something that returns a unit, I don't want it to compile. Or like something that returns not on the unit, like I want it to work on everything except for this specific type. Okay, there are some people. So there is like it's a hack. So Miles came up with this hack. The whole idea of this hack is where he basically defines a type class that witnesses that A is not a subtype of B, and then he defines some ambiguous implicits for the case where A is basically a subtype of B. And so when you say like I don't want, and then some more magic, and then what just in the functions you basically provide the type that you don't want it to be the subtype of, and then basically the implicit resolution will kick in, and if it's not a subtype of the specific type unit in this case, this implicit will be found and nothing will be will just happen. And then if it is a subtype of unit or a unit, this implicit will be found, and then this implicit will be found, and then you'll get that the compiler error saying, like, I have too many implicits, do something. Right? So we kind of have a result where we get a compiler error for... We have a compiler error for a case where we wanted compiler error, we don't have compiler error for the case where we didn't want compiler errors. But we get some very weird error message about, like, ambiguous implicits.
We actually get two of them, and they're completely impossible to understand if you don't understand.
Ah, you get two of them. Okay. Yeah. So you kind of get the result that you wanted, but you don't get, like, user friendliness at all. It's just, like, horrible. So instead of getting that, you get a compiler error with the implicit ambiguous annotation on ambiguous implicits that you provide. You get a compiler error saying returning that type is forbidden, returning unit is forbidden, which is nicer. It's still a hack, but it's a nicer error message for that hack. Singleton types. Singleton types are one of those things that are behind the flags, because, like, things that I showed you before that, those things they happen at the except for annotation. Those things are happening in the distributing phase of the compiler. So, like, it doesn't really change anything. So it still behaves the same way. Single types are happening in the cipher, I guess. In the what?
App river.
In well, yeah.
App river for erasure.
Yeah. So what are singleton types? I immediately have this, like, weird example. Okay. Yeah. Sure. I'll. This is a singleton type. K dot type. It's not K, like big K. It's a small K dot type. So it has only one inhabitant, which is of type k dot type. An example of a very, very simple singleton type is, like, 7 dot type. It has only one inhabitant, 7. So, like, 8 is not a 7 dot type. It's like, it's a type that basically captures the fact that what's in the value. So this is a potential use case for singleton types. Has anyone seen shapeless records? Yeah. Okay. Not many. So shapeless records. Has anyone heard about H-lists? Okay, that's right. So shapeless records actually are basically H-lists which contain tuples of things. And on the left, the thing is usually a singleton type, which is used as a key, and then on the right there is some value. So basically, the whole idea of that is to use the left side as a key in the map, and then the right side as a value in the map. So what they're using it for, what it could be used for, can be used for, and useful for, is basically building a heterogeneous map where some values are indexed by singleton types, 7 dot type, 8 dot type, etc. So this is like poor man's implementation of that. We define some trait which is trying to witness the association of some key with some value, and this is the value. This is the type of the value. This is the key. It doesn't appear anywhere here. It's just a key for, like, you know, compile time purposes. It's not gonna be anywhere in the runtime. This is how we make one of those. So to provide, we want to provide a key. We want to provide a value. And we want to get out the association of the key dot type, not key, not k, but, like, the key dot type, and a value. Well, and this is like pretty straightforward. This is how you construct. You just like put that there, like this. There. And then one of the possibilities to find one of those things by a key is to perform an implicit resolution by the singleton type, k dot type. So because this k dot type is going to be different for different keys, it's not going to be like if you put the 7 there, it's not going to be an, it's going to be a 7 dot type. So this is how you do it. You find an implicit for that created thing. If it's there, if it's not, we're going to get a compile time error, and we take out the value, and the type is dependent on whatever we fetch out of here. So yeah, this doesn't probably make much sense, but I'll show you how you use it. So we create a few of those. We create the first thing, which is like associates a one with like a panda for some reason, and then we create the second thing, which associates a two with a some double digit. And if you look at the types, this is an association with a key of int 1. This is an association of key with an int 2. So those are two different implicits. They are not of the same type. This one is int 1, this one is int 2. It's not like two ints. And then the same thing for like strings, because why not? And then using the lookup that we defined over here, because those are implicits and we can resolve them by this type over here, we can start trying to find those. So if we do lookup one, there we go. There it is. We find the string panda, and if we do lookup two, we find the double two. So. Oh. So notice that the types here are different, and like this looks like an int, but well, it is an int, but the lookup, the actual type parameter over here that gets passed is not an int, it's one dot type. And so the types are witnessed here, they're different in the same way that we created them. So this is a string, a double, an int, a string, and if we do a lookup of blah, it's going to say that there's no blah at compile time. Yeah, so it's kind of nice, kind of, I don't know, some people would say useless, but kind of fun. The other thing that we added is irrefutable pattern generators, generator patterns. And this for comprehension. Let's see what the sugars do. This is what the sugars do. Looks weird, but basically the thing to notice is that we are filtering the option over here, and if it's a tuple, then we're like falling through and then mapping, and if it's not a tuple, then we're not falling through. Which is weird, right? Like we statically know that that's a tuple, right? It's fun too, and like why are we filtering the things statically known to be a tuple? So with the irrefutable patterns, we just don't. So like that thing just disappears because we know that it's a tuple. There are what? Yeah, I haven't translated all the slides. So with there are some drawbacks. It's a different behavior. That's why we basically are hiding it behind the flag. So for example, if I had x comma not underscore but like 3 over here. It's still a tuple, but we would get a match exception. The canonical behavior would filter it out, because it doesn't conform to X at up 2. In our case, it will throw an exception, which is like, I don't know, it's kind of like valid behavior if you know what to expect. A very useful thing in this implementation is that if you want to extract patterns in the core comprehension on the left, your thing on the right, in this case option, needs to have a with filter. Otherwise, it just won't work. With our implementation, it just needs a map. And you will need a with filter only if you use a guard statement in a guard statement in the four comprehensions, basically option tuple if blah blah, then we'll use a with filter. So you know, reducing the amount of generated code is kind of nice. I forgot to translate the headline of the slide. It says nifties, basically. We added some again, pop parser level niceties to Scala. So like Scala in one of the languages that people in the community like to refer to, Haskell, you can have variables with primes after them, and people tend to like that, especially for nested functions where you, in this case, you want to compute the Fibonacci numbers, you want to call the internal function a Fibonacci prime, basically, which you can do now. And you can use a pound sign, a huge addition. And we have a literal for bytes. So that is literal for bytes and same way as how literal for more. So the whole vision for tab level compiler is bleeding edge. This is what I try to express with like this blood and mountains. we want to basically, right now we're on 2.11 branch of Scala C. We obviously are not gonna release for 2.10. We are kind of thinking to go to 2.12, but then I listened to Dmitry today and apparently it makes sense to go directly to 14. Especially given that singleton types are already implemented there, and I bet they're a lot less buggy than the Scala C implementation.
And parser didn't change much, so I guess most of your modifications can be justified.
Yeah, perfect. So, yeah. And Doty, that's my favorite thing. I wanted to say that Doty, the search system, has a search system effect, so it's going to be perfect. No pressure. If you ever want to contribute, because like currently it's a very low volume project, it's just like me updating from Scala C, like backporting changes from Scala C like every half a year, basically. And, sometimes you get a chance to work on some things, but you know. So if you ever want to contribute, just like working on Test Suite would be greatly appreciated. There's Scala Test Suite is what they call bar test. It's a thing which creates a REPL, like spins up the whole compiler in the REPL and like puts things that you want to put there and then compares the output with the check file. So that's like, it runs in parallel, but it's very, very, very slow. The whole test suite takes like at least 45 minutes. I think on this machine it takes like an hour at least. But they have a lot of JUnit tests, which just test the internals of the compiler. And that test suite just finishes in like, 5 minutes. ensure it. So, oh, by the way, there are these ideas that contributing to Scala compiler is weird because they have like this ant build and like it's not even Maven and not even SPT. Look, it's SPT. All the operations, as far as I know, have been completely migrated to SVT. And if you run tests, it will run the JUnit test suite, it will first compile it, and then run it. I think it's going to run faster than I can finish showing you the slides. So yeah, another thing which would be greatly appreciated is like some documentation, reporting, and fixing bugs. Fixing is even better than reporting. There's a bunch of reported bugs. And backporting changes from TypeSafe Scala is, yeah, that would be great. That would really relieve me from doing that. Can you talk a little bit about like things that we don't really plan to do right now because like we don't have bandwidth, but it would be nice to like, you know, fantasize, and it's not on the roadmap of Scala C at least. It could be on the roadmap of type level Scala. There are a lot of people trying to implement, so for example, refinement types, which could be built on top of singleton types. Or refinement types is basically, to remind you, singleton types is basically that. Access of type 7 to type 7. If we expand that to basically a function that like takes the thing and like ignores it and returns a 7, that should be like equivalent, right? And then we could expand that to be like some predicate. So that's basically a refinement type. That could be possible to implement. Like there are some ideas, like I played around, it's very hard. There are some C improvers who do just that, but integrating them in Scala C is just a pain. Another thing which comes up in several talks apparently is experimenting more with standard libraries, like Dottie wants to have a proper standard library that, you know, should type check with dot and all that. And type level, family of projects has different approach to like, you know, basic collections and type classes, and they call it CATS, which is like a more modular a contemporary attempt at Scala Z, I think. Maybe working a little bit on alternative RAD model. This is a picture of Ammonite, which is one of the alternative REPLs. And then another thing that comes up fairly often is rethinking the role of implicit and just rethinking the thing like how implicit works, because implicit resolution is crazy. It's like 10 clause rules, I think. It's like the most complex thing in the Scala stack, as far as I'm concerned. I gave a talk that's called "There's a Prolog in Your Scala if You're Interested." Like if you see the whole implicit resolution thing as like a graph traversal prolog style, it kind of makes sense. But it's still it's a very like hard thing. It's a very complex system, and a lot of people think that it could be made easier. There are several ideas in the type level compiler issues. One of them is implicit weight. So like for example, if you have several implicits, you can like assign weights to them to not have to like hide them in different layers or different units of compilation. That's one of the ideas. So again, you can try it out like that, or to 11.8-snapshot. Don't try to 11.9-snapshot. It's there, but it doesn't work. If you want to check out the Scala compiler or TLC compiler, this is how you check that your edition works before sending a pull request. There are other tools in the compiler that will help you run your tests more precisely. Like if you want only the tests with singleton types, but and thanks. Okay, so one question is more like an answering question, but so you had this link to your doc that you research abroad in your scholar. Just for fun, I made a prototype, something called PyPlot, which is an actual kind of very small subset of code you can bounce to scholar. You should try that.
Is it on your GitHub?
Yes. Yeah. Very nice, thank you very much. Yes. Irrefutable patterns, yes.
What is the sign though? In practice, the bytecode production is nice, but in fact, any modern JVM jitter will delete that check always in terms of trivial flow. So the runtime performance benefit will be negative for you.
I think obviously not having to have a with filter on the thing is a nice thing. For example, so like you can use something that doesn't have a with filter, and then there is reduces the API size required to you to use those things if you want to also use like patterns and the for something. So basically, you need map and pattern. That's all.
I did like your proposed syntax for type lambdas. Did you have an idea to create a SIP for adding this syntax or, say, future Scala?
So the author of that is, I think, Eric Ostheim, and I think he started several conversations in the like Scala internals and all that. I'm not sure if he has a SIP. I should ask. But yeah, I mean, it's a fairly like straightforward addition and very useful. No? Oh, it's just a change in the parser basically. It just like expands that thing to a type one. That's all.
Work the same way you would expect them to do. One of the features that we think is better. Good luck in building it.
Okay.
If type 1 that is just a simple macro expansion, why Paul Phillips warned against them? What are the, you know, stones on the water?
Yes, maybe I should answer. The stones under the water of type lambdas is the hash that you have inside the type lambda. This hash that you have written there,
that projection,
it's not clear what it means at all. There is no theory which says what this hash means at all. And all the way how this hash is implemented in compiler is very ad hoc. And in Dottie, if you want to have hash, you need to have minus on your story.
Well, but hash is included in Scala.
What hash means is only clear for if your prefix is a Java class. Then you're fine. Otherwise, there are counterexamples that show that hash, simple hash without anything additional, is unsound.
So, like if you have like a type parameter and a type number or something?
Okay. So, if you're interested to look at the details, have a look at issue, go to issue tracker. It has an issue called hyper-protection is unsound.
I think we're done. Go have a beer.